Space Kitter, hey Chris. I'll forgo the intro music and just rock up early. I have a little pre-stream chat. So let's just get this. It's a bit. Oh, hello. Test. Am I loud enough? Okay, cool. All right. I keep realizing there's all these little tiny pieces of terminology that, one moment. Let me just mute my screen. Just realized I'm on the wrong desktop. I'll put you somewhere. All right, that's better. Why is that not going up? Weird. Come on, little bar. Oh, that's really annoying. Let's try this again. Oh, wow. That's a weird bug. Oh, excellent. Okay. Found a way to hide the silly controls. Okay, alright. Excellent. Alright, so the small number of viewers, welcome to the Early Bird Club. Any questions left over from last lecture, just in case I can address them at the start of this lecture? Oh, okay, good. Good stream rate. No razor. Question 1B of the Simon. Yeah. Can you remind me what it is? Close down everything unnecessary. I don't want to crack open my PDF viewer. Oh, yeah. Yeah, so when I mentioned it in the lectures, I mean, I know it is one for other reasons. I didn't think hard about the actual technique of proof. So my suggestion wasn't chase all the way to the end to check if it works. But it does work. I mean, the proof works. It is a quasi-isomorphism. It's just might need to think around the definition a little bit more. Hey Tyson. Yep. Yeah, we'll start closer to the half hour. My view account, it's not going up a lot. Okay, I'm ready. Stay hydrated. Stay caffeinated. I'm all teed up. Got a bowl of nibblies. too prepared. It's not. And feeling better today. Weekend was not great, but I'm definitely on the way up. I might even be well by the time the class is finished. Six viewers. So today is the deadline for taking a course of credit, if I recall Thomas's email. Space Kidder. No, but I've read a very amusing review of that book, New Kind of Science. And having read some of its author's blog posts, I can definitely see how one could very quickly arrive at such a view. Yeah, it's the one that says, it quotes the remark from someone else. As much as new and much that is correct, but that which is correct is not new, and that which is new is not correct. But the reviewer goes on to add, and there's plenty of old wrong stuff too. Okay. Pretty harsh burn. Yeah, the one where the reviewer says he was sued by Wolfram for merely mentioning the existence of a proof written by someone else who was being paid by Wolfram and wasn't allowed to contractually disclose that they'd written a proof. Obscene. Anyway, thankfully, do not seem to be too many people like that. Oh, there are plenty out there, but not the majority. Alright, if Tyson's back, come on Tyson, roll up. I've got plenty of content today. So do you need to read New Kind of Science again, or the review? Well, yeah, I might just roll into starting with the lecture. Alright, anyone else that we're waiting for? All right. So yeah, so the big definition that we gave at the end of towards the end of last lecture is the definition of a final topology. So if you want to get one really serious thing out of the topology section of this course, and it's probably not one you've seen, they don't tend to talk about it in like metric space intro topology type courses, definitely not in like functional analysis type topology courses. Final topology is like the big ingredient. I mean, you're going to have a look at the initial topology in the assignment, but the final topology is the one that's more hardcore. Where all the fun comes from. quite literally, it's like, yeah. All right, so we're gonna do some examples of this, and let's I'm going to build ourselves up to a point where we can make spaces. Okay. Yeah, we had that there is a category of topological spaces. Maybe I should just remark. Say there exists a category. Top star pointed spaces. So it's a topological space with a chosen point. And continuous functions that send the base point to the base point. And there's also a category of pairs of spaces. And by pairs, I mean the technical sense. So it's, let's say, top with a little bracketed 2, so the objects look like, so X is a space, a topological space, A is a subspace, so it's a subset, possibly more generally just, well, yeah, a subset equipped with subspace topology. Someone tell me I introduced that phrase last time. I really should have, and I just erased everything from last lecture. So that's the topology gotten by restricting the topology on X to A. All right, and the morphisms. Okay. That's the case where I had like an injective function or the inclusion map, and I get the topology on A by just intersecting all the open sets of X with A. Yeah, okay. I mean, I mentioned the concept, but I'm not sure if I mentioned the name. So I had like, and I have a topology on X, and I get topology restricted to A. And the morphisms here are, so maps from X to continuous functions from X to Y, such that I've got to put the other ones in. So scrub. So that's an A. So the continuous functions F from X to Y, such that F of the image of F under A sits inside B. Space kid, I'm not quite sure what the question is. So that's the tau subscript mathcal B is the I use it for the topology generated by a base. Yep, so base. So here I just mean so you just intersect all the opens with A. Okay. Anyway, so these are some other categories you get. Okay. So here's another definition which the word has been bandied around. So a continuous function F from X to Y. So I'm going to now start having the topologies implicit unless I specifically need to mention them. So everything is now equipped with a topology, and so X and Y topological spaces. So such a thing is called homeomorphism, or if I'm being lazy, just an isomorphism, but technically a homeomorphism, if it is a bijection and we could write down its set theoretic inverse function is also continuous. So for instance, there's a homeomorphism between a standard topological simplex. Let's write down, take its boundary. It's easier. That's not probably what I want. I write it down explicitly. There's a homeomorphism between the standard topological simplex and the ball of around 0 of radius 1 inside Rn. And there's nothing special about the number 1 or the position 0. So, I mean, one thing you can do is find the centroid, I suppose, of this topological simplex, translate everything so that hits at 0, and then scale everything, puff it out. All right. So that's a word we need to know. Here's another one. So I talked about a subspace, but I want something slightly more general. So an injective continuous function, let's call it I, from U to X. These are both spaces. Subspace embedding so basically you look at the topology on U and compare it to the one induced by I. Alright, so remember, if I have a function from a set to a topological space, I can induce a topology on the domain of the function by taking the inverse image of all the open sets on the codomain. So I'm not asking that U is actually a subset. Yeah, so it turns out, Chris, that it is homeomorphic to its image. So then, like U, it's homeomorphic to its image. Where the image, I mean, what does that mean, right? So the image is a literal subset of X, and we give it the subspace topology. So this is just a very, very slight generalization of that, where I don't care that U is actually a subset of X. And I sort of rely on this sort of sleight of hand quite often. So for instance, if I take the topological N minus 1 simplex, right, these maps, partial I, right? They're topological embeddings, so they're subspace embeddings, possibly topological embeddings, because, right, what are these spaces, right? This sits inside Rn, this sits inside Rn plus 1, and definitely, like, we don't think of delta n minus 1 is literally inside delta n. I mean, we have lots of options here, but it's as good as, right? So via the map, various maps delta I, it's as good as subspace. A good non-example, so that's a 1. There's a non-example. We can take the rational numbers, so the discrete topology, so every subset is open, sits inside the reals. This has its Euclidean topology, or metric topology. I'm sure I had a dream about this once. It's a bit weird. This is a non-example. So Q has as with the discrete topology, has many, many more open sets. And you might think, I mean, this is just talking about the subspace topology, but how do you build the reals anyway? I mean, it's something like maybe equivalence classes of Cauchy sequences. So, whereas Q is like a pair of integers, mod sum equivalence relation, you know, or R is like Dedekind cuts or something like this. So, thinking of it as like literally a subset is technically not true, but you know, category theory says we can get away with it. All right. R here is dragon. R here is the real numbers. So, as a metric given by standard Euclidean distance, and we give it the metric topology, and that's the whole, that's the classic epsilon delta sort of type of arguments in real analysis. All right. All right, so here's let's do something a bit more sophisticated. I just wanted to say some of these words. So this is a more fancy example of the final topology. Okay, so let's suppose we have a sequence of topological spaces and injective continuous functions. For all n. So you should vaguely have in the back of your mind, we did something about like the skeleta of a delta set, but this is not delta sets, but it's sort of morally similar. So we can define this, that I might call U X infinity. I mean, I want to write it as the union over all the X of all the Xn's. So you might go, but really, David, how are we taking this union? Because they don't really sit inside anything. So what I really mean is, this is as a set. I haven't given it a topology yet. I take the disjoint union of all the Xn's, and I want to identify a point with its image under I. So here X, this is for all X, for all N. So if I have a point in like X0, it gets identified with its image in X1, in X2, X3, and so on. So they're all the, like, there's like a countable number of copies of X0 sitting inside all the different things here, and I collapse them all together. So maybe a, yeah, try not to give a right. So this is like X0, X1, this is I0, and here is I1. Maybe it gets a little bit distorted, who knows. Doesn't matter. And so on. This is X2. And then sitting inside here, I've got like I0 of X0. This is, I grab my microphone. I1 of X1, but sitting inside that is I1 of I0 of X0. And so I'm gonna glue on, sort of identify all the various copies. So like there's X 100, and then there's countably many more copies of x100 inside x101, x102, I glue them all together. Right, so that gives me a set. So it's like the union, basically. So alternatively, I could actually start with a set x infinity. And then I have, if you like, a filtration. So I actually have all these nested subsets. And topologies. And the inclusion maps are continuous. For the topologies tau n and tau n plus 1. It doesn't matter either way. Really, I just want to say I have a bunch of spaces that include into each other by some injective continuous functions, and then I have a big set, which is kind of the union of them all. Here I should say something like the union of all the xn's is equal to x infinity. So this is like as a subset of x infinity. Okay, and so this is gluing the ions together. And then I can take the final topology. So then, final topology on x infinity. Right, I have all these maps Jn. Include xn as a subset inside x infinity. So this is called, sometimes it might be called the inductive limit topology, but I don't really use that. I want to say sequential. That's an old terminology. Sequential co-limit topology. And so what does this mean? It means that a subset U in X infinity, which a priori is just given as X infinity is just a set. This is open I want to say something like U intersect XN is open for all N. So literally, like, okay, if it's not actually a subset, I might really replace this by Jn inverse of U, if you want to be a bit more formal. But you can think of it as just the intersection of U with each of the finite stages. Okay, so what's a good example of this? So we know, let's write down everyone's favorite finite dimensional manifold. The n-sphere, and we have functions which include the n-sphere into the next bigger one. By sticking a zero on the end. And then we take S infinity to be the union of all the Sn's. In the way discussed above. And give it the final topology, and this is the infinite dimensional sphere. Sequential co-limit topology. Infinite dimensional sphere. So, in fact, it's nice, you can actually, we know that each Sn sits inside Rn plus 1, and you can play this game with Rn plus 1 instead. So S infinity is a subspace of R infinity, which is a union of all the Rn's. And so it's really the same thing as the space of polynomials over R with real coefficients. And moreover, this is not like it's not sort of infinite dimensional in the sense of like a Hilbert space, infinite dimensional Hilbert space, or what have you. In R, that's even scarier. So because every element of this R infinity is a vector of a finite length. It's just that you can then pad it with infinitely many zeros, and there are unbounded, they're vectors with unboundedly many non-zero entries. Yeah, so this R of X, this is like purely algebraic thing, but since R has a topology, we can actually give this polynomial ring a topology. That's definitely not Hilbert space because it's not complete, because you can have a sequence of like the 1, then all zeros, then 1, 1, and all zeros, and then 1, 1, 1, and all zeros. And this gives you a sequence which doesn't converge to anything, because like the all 1's infinitely long vector doesn't sit inside this R infinity. Okay. So that's a relevant real-world example. We may see the infinite sphere again a little bit later. Any questions? Otherwise, someone tell me, just keep going. Keep going. All right. Don't slow down now. Okay. So here's a fundamental fact about the final topology. In fact, it's the whole point. So we have a functions from Z alpha to X. X are spaces. And here's the lemma. So a function out of X is continuous for the final topology, and whatever topology is given on Y, if and only if I compose G with all my F alphas. This is now a function from Z alpha to Y, and Z alpha had some pre-given topology, and Y has some pre-given topology. And so then, without any reference to the final topology or X, I can say what it means for G compose F alpha to be continuous. So one direction of the proof just uses continuous compose continuous equals continuous. That's the easy part. The other direction, so if U is open in Y, the function G, yes, sorry, G from X to Y. Thank you, DMN. So yes, it is a universal property, Chris. Well, it's oh dear, please don't crash. Right, I'm just going to clean this into a G in a more clever way. Yeah, it's related to the universal property. Technically something about, I'm not gonna go there. Too deep a rabbit hole. It is a universal property. Let's take this one open. just might not be the one you're thinking of. And so we need G inverse U in X open. That's what we need to prove that G is continuous. Sorry, Sleepy, I haven't really got time to answer that. But I can say it's only a simple harmonic motion under the small angle approximation, where we assume sine theta is approximately equal to theta. Otherwise, it's a non-linear DE. All right, so we need G inverse U to be open in X. But what does it mean to be open in X? Because it has the final topology, I need to look at the inverse image and all the F alphas. This is true precisely when F alpha inverse of G inverse X is open in Z alpha for all alpha. And this is the same as G composed F alpha inverse of U. But this is open, so, but G composed F alpha is continuous, so G composed F alpha inverse U is continuous, is open, as we needed. Okay, so that's kind of cool. You're welcome, Sleepy Sam. All right, so here's a quick example of that, and it's going to lead into a lemma. Panic Jed, it's related to the universal property of the co-limit, but more the fact that okay, you asked for it. This category of topological spaces is an amnestic construct over the category of sets. And so if we've already got a co-limit in the category of sets, and we're going to lift it to a co-limit in the category of topological spaces, then this is what we need to check. And so there's some vibration property, probably some co-Cartesian arrow morphisms and so on and so on. It's like crazy terminology. But as far as like what we're considering, it's super concrete. This is like concrete, and it's the sort of stuff that inspired people to invent the category theory. Okay, so here's an example. Let's say X was the space that's the disjoint union of a bunch of spaces Z alpha. And I have a function F to Y. So I can forget about the X. I just think, okay, disjoint union of all the Z alphas. And the I have all these in beta inclusions. So this F is continuous precisely when G restricted to the Z alpha is continuous for all alpha. And since X is partitioned into all these Z alphas, they don't really touch each other. The topology doesn't sort of make them stick to each other. If you just look at F on each blob, Z is like a blob, right? If you just look at F restricted to each blob and it's continuous on each blob, then it's continuous everywhere. Because if you're thinking like a metric space sense, like you can't have a sequence inside one blob that whose limit is in a different blob because they're disjoint. Although in category of metric spaces, it doesn't make as much sense. You need to allow infinite distances for this type of stuff to work. But I just need some notation. So I write, that's an F, sorry. Assuming F's and G's. I'll write F is this angle bracket of all these, I'm going to call this F alpha. It's the angle bracket of all the F alphas. So it's like I have a tuple of functions, but it's not like a function whose values are tuples, it's the other way around. I'm just going to have a tuple of functions mapping out of a disjoint union notation. Okay. So, I've got this far and haven't mentioned the word closed yet. So, naughty me. It is got topology in the title of the course. Definition. Everyone's allowed to give me a boo in chat. So it is called closed. So X has a topology tau. Yeah, thanks, Peacekeeper. It's called closed for this topology if the complement inside X is open. Well, I should say, what does that even mean? Is open for tau? V complement is an element of tau. Okay. Sorry, I just need to say that. I need to insert Hitler learns topology downfall meme right about now. Sets can be open and closed. Or neither. Every combination is possible. So every subset of a discrete topological space is also closed. So, e.g., and open. Yeah, Clopen, yay. So for instance, something weird happens with the rationals in the subspace topology from the reals, but I it's totally disconnected, or whatever that means. But it's not quite, there are lots of Clopen subspaces in the rationals. Subspaces in the rationals with the subspace topology from the reals. Anyway, so I've got a, so here's some examples of final topology that are important. So let's let a collection of subsets, open subsets, so of X, so this be an open cover. So cover generically means that the union of the things is all of X. So then X has the final topology with respect to these I alpha maps. So you can check this by saying, well, a set is open in X. I have to take its inverse image under all the I alphas, but that's the same with intersecting with a U alpha. And if that's open, then, well, I can kind of just take the union of a bunch of the, you know, here's axioms of like what open sets do. It's a fun little exercise. And so this is sort of point one. Point two, so if now let's take closed cover, finite closed cover, so Vn's closed and their union is all of X. And I have these JNs. X has a final topology with respect to the JNs. So from this we get a lovely lemma, sort of a corollary, if you like, of the previous lemma, but this one is kind of named. So assume we're given a function f from x to y, these are spaces. I'm not assuming that f is continuous a priori. If I have an open cover of x, and I restrict f to each open set in the cover, then the whole thing is continuous. So it's continuous locally, right? So somehow open sets, I mean, you could do the same thing with like a base for a basis for a topology or a base. Say, well, if it's continuous on each element of the base, that's like, well, each element of the base is somehow meant to be close to some points. So if it's continuous close to some points for all points, so it's continuous close to every point, then it's continuous everywhere. So so the same is true, I should say, f is continuous if and only if I restrict to vn's for a finite closed cover. Finite is important here because of the way the definition of topology is not symmetric between intersections and unions. So bit of highlight on that. Okay, so I got one more example of a final topology, and then try to get to the main definition I wanted to cover today. So all of these get used all the time. So one more example. So let's give a topological space. And here I'm being careful to write the topology. And some collection of continuous functions. I'm already assuming they're continuous. Let's call them T alpha from big T alpha into X. So the big T alphas don't necessarily need to be all distinct. But I've just got a bunch of T alphas. I mean, all the the capital T alphas. Okay, little T is probably a bad. I've got too many T alphas. Call it P alpha. All right. All the T alphas could be the same, for instance, but the P alphas might be different. So here's an example. Take T alpha to be R, for the real numbers, and then P alpha is like all the continuous functions from R into my space. This is an option. All continuous functions. This is a situation that turns up in actual practice. all right, but now I have I can forget the fact that X is a space. I just needed that to know that the P alphas were continuous. Now I just have spaces T alpha and a bunch of functions to a set. Now give X the final topology. Respect to the P alphas. Let's just call this T twiddle. Now, it possibly adds new open sets, right? Because now the restriction for a set to be open in X is much weaker, because there might be functions that whose continuity would be imperiled by some open sets that arise in T twiddle. I mean, take for instance, let's say T alpha was a single point space. Right? It's just a single point. It has a unique topology. It only has two subsets, and both of them are forced to be opened by the axioms. And let's take the P alphas to be all the possible functions, which is same as all continuous functions, to X. Then the new topology is the discrete topology on X. So there are more open sets possibly. So possibly and so turns out you can check there is a continuous function from X tau twiddle to X tau, namely the identity function. And it's not continuous. So the thing about topologies is it's like it's continuous for topology one, topology two in a specific order. If we swap the topologies, even if the underlying set is the same, it may not be continuous. So unless T twiddle equals tau twiddle equals tau, it's not continuous thought of as a function from X tau to X tau twiddle. Okay. So that's a thing you can do, which is kind of interesting. And in practice, people use this construction. So we might get a topological space from a certain class of spaces, which is iffy. Yeah, so the identity is a bijection, but it's not a homeomorphism here. So it's only continuous in one direction. So you really have to think of it not as the identity function. It's a function from this topological space to this topological space, and they're different because the data is different, because the topologies are different. And if you like, you could, you know, think of like one of the X's as being a different set that happens to be bijective to your original X. So, yeah. So anyway, this process is used to take a space. Maybe you made a space through some process and it's not quite as nice as you want, and you apply this process and the new space is slightly nicer. Usually it's not too far from X, and the example I'm thinking of, cohomology can't tell them apart. So neither can a whole bunch of other tools. So it's like, as far as cohomology goes, you might as well work with a nicer space because it gives the same invariance. All right, so here's the big definition that I wanted to give in this. All right, this is the construction. All right, so the course started out with roughly with delta sets as combinatorial models for spaces, but nothing we've seen so far, and I've been very careful to emphasize this, delta sets are not spaces. And how do we even get a space? I mean, in what sense should a delta set model a topological space? It's not clear. on the face of it. And so this is why we do this construction. I mean, before we had the okay, take a topological space and we made a delta set. I mean, I said metric space, but it makes sense for all topological spaces. This SM, this is a delta set, but it's absolutely enormous. And so using it as a model for your topological space, it's kind of a formal thing. Whereas if I said, oh, the boundary of the combinatorial simplex is a model for the boundary of the topological simplex, it's only a metaphor at this point. So here's, so going from spaces to delta sets is fine, but it gives you something hugely inefficient. We don't have something going back the other way. So I'm going to fix a delta set X. And so what is the data? It's this collection of sets XN. I have the functions DI, etc. So I want to build a topological space. Unfortunately, this notation conflicts slightly with that of a norm, but it's what it is. Okay, so I mean, there's a short definition, but I prefer the one I'm about to give because it's shows what's going on. So one, first we treat each xn, right, these are sets, as a discrete topological space. So it's just a bunch of points. Two. So we make, right, since it's a topological space, we can make the product space, put the product topology on this, and where my delta n is my topological n simplex. So it's quite nice that this is the same thing up to homeomorphism as the disjoint union of xn many copies of delta n. So I can think of it as, like, in this direction it's discrete, and in this direction I have some n simplex, and so it's like a bunch, oops, for each thing in here I've got a bunch of n simple topological n simplices, but I want to write it as a product because it's cleaner. It's not hugely important, but it's cleaner. Now let's define, I'm going to have an inductive definition here. So this thing less than zero as, well, it's the zero simplex, topological zero simplex, that's just a point. So this is homeomorphic to just xn as a discrete space. So this is going to be just my starting point. I'm just sprinkling some points in space. Now, nothing up my sleeves. And stop, please stop me at any point during this process. This is a pretty major construction. So, pushouts, what are they? Okay. As you'll see when I scan my notes, I had some thinking on paper. All right, so I want to take xn plus 1 times delta n. So this is not quite what I wrote above, but it's the same sort of thing. And how many of these do I have? I take 1 for every face of how delta n sits inside delta n plus 1. So I should think of the domain of this map as a bunch of, no, I should think of the codomain of this map. Right, I have a bunch of topological n plus one simplices, and I have as many as are given by the set x n plus one. So this is just a set. You think of it as an indexing set of how many n plus one simplices I need. And for each face of this n plus one simplex, which is an n simplex, topological n simplex, and where face I mean in the sort of generalized subspace embedding earlier, I have a face. And so, well, I have one of those per face of the delta n plus one. So that's given by this disjoint union here. And that's, that's a thing. And I can now map, what else, what other data do I have? I have the D maps, the face maps for the delta set. So I can map down here to x n, and I keep the topological n simplex floating around. And then I can fold all these together. So this is now, so this bit here, this previous step, this is just a disjoint union of a stack of copies of the same thing. And so I can look at all of them mapping onto this a single copy. So it's like I have a bunch of n simplices and I just map them to a single n simplex. Sort of parameterized by xn. Now I have this map phi n. So this is what I'm defining inductively. So I presume I already have, so the induction step is, I assume I have this. And the phi n is continuous. So then I'll do, I form a push-out space. So what this means is that I take the disjoint union of this topological space and this topological space, then quotient by the equivalence relation generated by, if anything here comes from here, I have to identify it with its image over there, gluing them together, and then give it the final topology for the maps, the two maps into it. I want to call this I, let's call this, yeah. It's a different I from up there. Let's call this JN. Phi N plus one. And now I have the new data. I have the phi N plus one, which is continuous because I constructed the bottom right hand corner using the final topology automatically assures me that phi n plus 1 is continuous, that jn is continuous, and I can repeat. Okay, so by induction I had a sequence and so I can take the union of them all, and define this, the set, to be, this is called the geometric realization. Oh, did I save that somewhere earlier? Don't know if I did. I'm going to explain this push out a little bit in a moment. Oh yeah, okay. And we give X the sequential colimit topology. Okay, top limit, second disjoint union. Oh yeah, sorry, that's not infinity, sorry. That's n plus one. Oh, what am I doing? Doesn't make sense. Okay, thank you, DMN. Okay, so what is happening here? What I'm doing, I'm starting off with x0, it's less than or equal to 0, less than or equal to 1, less than or equal to 2. So I'm starting with this space, which is discrete. It's just a bunch of points. And then I'm taking, right, n equals 0. So let's assume n equals 0 here. I look at this. This is a bunch of delta 1s, which are intervals. How many do I have? As many as given by x1. And this one, this map down here, right, this delta 1 is a point. I have n equals 0. So what do I have? Yep, so I have two copies of whatever's here. And this map picks out the two points in this space that are the endpoints of the intervals. And then, so this is, yeah, this is a bunch of disjoint intervals. This is a bunch of points, and this push out attaches the endpoints of the intervals to the points they should attach to. Okay, we go up one step. Now we have basically a topological graph. And up here I have a bunch of triangles, because n equals 1. So now this is delta 2. It's a bunch of triangles, as many as are indexed by x2. This map picks out the boundaries, picks out the three edges, which are the boundaries of the triangles, as encoded by x2 mapping down to x1. It tells me which elements at x1 come from edges of an element in x2, just abstractly. And then this pushout glues a triangle to the three edges in the directed, it's not the directed graph, in the topological graph that should be the boundary of that triangle, and so on. So each JN, I've glued on topologically higher dimensional simplices. Okay. So if I start out with something n-dimensional, so it means it has no higher simplices than dimension n, this stops at x less than or equal to n, which actually equals the full thing at this point, because empty set times topological n simplex is the empty set, and you push out doesn't give you anything new. You're taking the disjoint union with the empty set, which is your same thing, and there's no quotienting happening. Okay. Cool. Now, this is a pretty hardcore procedure. But what it is doing, this is in a rigorous way, is saying, imagine I drew a picture that encoded some delta set that I'm actually making
that picture out of topological things. So the other thing I want to say just before I finish, so this process is functorial, which, if you've never seen it before, is mildly surprising because it's complicated as all anything. But all it uses is the universal property of pushout and the definition of the final topology. What does it mean to be a map out of something formed like by a sequential colimit, or as a pushout to be continuous? So I will be a bit more detailed about that later. So just to sort of summarize, I suppose if S is a map, delta sets continuous function between their geometric realizations, and it preserves composition, in respects composition. And the identity map, the geometric mirrorization of the identity map, is the identity function. Okay, and maybe one example. I will revisit this and talk about why this is functorial. And you can all sort of have a think about various things we've seen, even like low dimensional things, sort of see how it might work. But yeah, it's very much just gluing topological things together in a way that we've been actually secretly drawing delta sets, but whereas delta sets are just combinatorics. You know, like this topological n simplex is just, you know, lists of things increasing order and so on, whereas this is a subset of Rn plus 1. Yeah. So yeah, maybe as a special case of this. I better stop. There's too much cool stuff happening here. But this is how we're going to link the combinatorial stuff to the topological stuff. Cool. I will catch you all tomorrow. We've got 2 lectures tomorrow. We're on the home stretch. And we'll see some fun stuff this week. So, catch you later. Questions on Discord, please. This is pretty heavy, so bug me to explain it more. Hey, you're welcome, Josh. You're welcome, Space Kidder. I missed my stop button. All right, here it is.